Hello, hello everyone, and welcome to lesson two of the goal of low inflation. Our second domestic macroeconomic goal, the first if you're just going in the order of the study design, but I'm not because I'm just a maniac. But today we're going to be looking at specifically moving on from what we did in the first lesson of just what the goal is and how that impacts on living standards, and moving on to how we calculate inflation through the CPI, what that means. We're also going to be looking at a little bit of limitations of around the goal and or around how we measure inflation, because it gives us a bit more scope to talk about what that measurement actually means and how effective it actually is. So moving on to our key knowledge and key skills for this, we have the measurement of the inflation rate using the consumer price index, including the difference between headline and underlying core, or the core rate of inflation. This is why we look at the limitations a little bit. The headline and underlying comes up throughout there about what we actually use to get rid of some of those limitations. And we're gonna look at what the CPI is and how it's measured, how to calculate that, because you could be asked to calculate that in a short answer or multiple choice question. So our key skills that line up with that: defining key economic concepts and terms and using them appropriately, and also calculating relevant economic indicators using real or hypothetical data. So let's get straight into it with what we are looking at. So inflation is measured through the consumer price index, which is a measure of inflation, or the average level of prices of a basket of goods or services that's purchased by a typical metropolitan household. So it doesn't look at every good or service, but it looks at a hypothetical basket of goods and services, to draw a basket over here, and looks at how much the prices of those change over time, if they go up or if they go down. Most often they're going to be going up, but sometimes, especially recently, we've had a little bit of deflation happening around the COVID pandemic. So it measures quarterly changes in retail prices of locally made and foreign made goods and services that represent a high proportion of the expenditure of metropolitan households in living in capital cities. So for the people in capital cities, it measures kind of like the most common goods and services purchased by those people living in those areas, to really find out if there is a change in the price of those goods and services. Because if there is, we can make a pretty clear distinction of what's going to be changed in terms of living standards. Because if the main goods and services people buy go up in price, that's going to decrease purchasing power or erode purchasing power, meaning that people are going to have less disposable income and aggregate demand is likely to fall because of that. So this really ties in with consumption spending. So if there's more inflation or the CPI is higher, it means there's going to be less consumption spending and less aggregate demand overall. So there, that's kind of what we're looking at there. So important features of the CPI. The first one we're going to look at is the regimen, which is just the goods and services that are included in the basket that's prices are to be measured. So it includes around 100,000 individual items that are subdivided into 11 categories that are weighted based on their importance, which we'll get to next. There is some variation in the amount of goods and services in that basket, depending on what you see and what resources you're looking at. But basically, the regimen is just the types of goods and services that are included. Then we've got the prices survey. So the quarterly price survey is carried out in a representative range of metropolitan retail outlets, spanning both the private sector, so things like Coles, etc., and the public sector, so things like local council property rates. The items are then weighted based on their overall importance in overall household expenditure, and these weightings are reviewed every 5 years. So weighted basically just means that if something's a need, it's given a stronger weighting of overall importance, because obviously that's going to be more relevant to a household's expenditure, and they're not going to be able to substitute that for something else if it goes up or down in price. So the weighting is kind of important there. So things like education, healthcare, etc., are going to be heavily weighted. Even things like petrol probably fairly heavily weighted, whereas other things that are more luxuries and not needs are going to be weighted smaller. Then we've also got the base year. The base year is essentially the period of time that we're comparing prices to. So the base year is given a value of 100. It's basically prices, that's what we're comparing to. So the prices are 100% then. So then anything after that base year is, if prices are increasing, it's going to be higher than 100. And we're using that to find out the percentage change overall. So essentially, it's kind of like when we look at consumer confidence, business confidence. With consumer confidence, 100 is essentially zero. If things go above 100, that means that prices have increased. And if things go below 100 or they move back in the other direction, that means that prices have decreased. So that's the main thing there. It's really just like, so if you get two dates, like if you get, say you get January 2020 and January 2019, and January 2019 is 107 and 2020 is 110, just comparing it to that first year that, so in 2019, its prices are 7% higher than they were in the base year. And just so you can find out the difference between those 2 years. So we are calculating CPI or inflation. What we're looking for is to find out the annual CPI rise or the inflation rate. So if we have two fake dates here, so if in June 2012 the CPI was measured at 100.4 against 99.2 points in June of 2011, this is how it would be calculated. So we've got the number of points that it's increased in CPI. So if we look at that, from 99.2 to 104, that is 1.2 times 100 over the value of CPI in its first year, which was 99.2, so that's the year we're comparing it against. If I get out my trusty phone to calculate that. So if we do 1.2 times 100, that's 120, pretty clearly. And then if we divide that by 99.2, let's just write that in there. That's going to equal 1.2% of inflation. So, and that's essentially how you calculate it. If we had another example, so if we use our example from before, so if we had 2019 and it was 107, and if we had it in 2020, that it was 110, so that would be the difference in them. So 3 times 100 over 107. So if we look at that, 3 times 100 is obviously 300 over 107. So divide that by 107, and that is going to equal 2.8%, which is probably more realistic of an inflation rate if there was for before 2020. Obviously, now they're going to be much, much lower. But that's essentially how you calculate it. So you work out the difference between those two measurements that you have. So you work out the difference, you times the difference by 100, and then divide it by the first year. If you can do that, you'll always be right when you have to calculate that. Then obviously you could have other things like comparing that to the goal, seeing if it's achieved or not. But for the most part, it's just calculating it. So the difference between the 2 years times 100 over the value of the first year. So some limitations of the CPI and why we use. So what we've been looking at so far is measuring the headline inflation rate. Now we're looking at why sometimes we need to use another measurement. So there's a lack of representativeness in prices sometimes. So because only 100,000 goods or services are surveyed, it's not always appropriate because only metropolitan households, regional areas may obviously have very different consumption habits and purchase different goods and services than metropolitan people do, because metropolitan areas these days are full of hipsters. If you've been to the country, can be very different. The weighting limitations for things in the regimen. So for some households, the weighting might not be appropriate. So things like if the price of meat skyrocketed, the inflation rate would be misleading for vegetarian or vegan households. Just a really clear representation there that if people don't purchase the goods and services that are heavily weighted in the inflation rate, then the inflation rate isn't going to really directly apply to them, which is a bit of an issue. And then also the effect of once-off volatile events on the headline inflation rate. So sometimes unavoidable once-off events can influence prices. So the big example I always use to talk about this is when I was in high school. So what is it? How old am I? I'm almost 32. So 14 years ago. Wow. Around 14 to 15 years ago, there was a cyclone in northern Queensland that wiped out all the banana crops. So all the bananas, to draw a banana here, so many of them got wiped out. And so those bananas suddenly got much more expensive. So the price of bananas went up crazily. Like I remember at one point bananas were $15 a kilo, which is insane. I worked a public holiday at Coles at the time. I bought one banana, that cost me about $3.50, which is insane. You could buy bananas are delicious, but you could buy a lot tastier treats for that price. So in cases like this, though, when things like that happen, these once-off events, it can lead to serious overstatements in the headline inflation rate because the price of one thing has gone up really high because of a very specific reason, which can overstate it. So then we often use the underlying inflation rate, which is measured by removing these volatile once-off events, such as changing some fresh food items from normal CPI regimen in order to gain a inflation rate that is more reflective of current price levels. So we take away these volatile once-off events to kind of get a more accurate depiction of how prices have really changed. And that's kind of going to give us a lot better. You're not going to have to calculate that, but you'll be given that sometimes, or suggesting that sometimes, as a better way. So like if you look at the bushfires last year, the bushfires drove up prices of some fruit and vegetables, it drove up the price of some other things. You'd want to remove that from the inflation rate to get a more accurate depiction of price changes, and therefore you'd use the underlying inflation rate in that case. All right, so that's it for this measuring inflation. Okay, then like the underlying and headline inflation rate limitations of that. Hopefully this was helpful for you. The main thing you need to take away from this is how to calculate inflation using CPI. If you can do that, you are going to do very well. As always, like to pump up, go to my website over there, join Discord where there is over 60 people discussing economics occasionally when they need help for Saxon stuff and not much otherwise, but it's good they get that help. They get a variety of voices giving them their expertise. Also, if you are feeling like you have some money that you'd like to throw in my direction, because I have an addiction to buying my daughter books, head to my website and buy things like this guide to task words in VC economics, which is going to be very, very helpful. It tells you basically how the marks are allocated to certain questions when certain task words are used and what you need to do to get those marks in a set of structured activities. On that, thank you for watching as always, and I hope you have a wonderful day, and I will see you, well, I won't see you, but you'll see me next time.